Hello and welcome everybody to the latest edition of the Jam and Cheese Show. Easter is finally done, and what a way to finish with the Tigers come from behind win against the Parramatta Eels. We'll get to that in a moment. Aiden Caesar with a great field goal. Young Lockie Galvin carving up after spending 10 minutes in the bin. But first off, Cheese, it feels like forever ago. Since you guys played against Penrith, how was the fallout from that game?
Can I just say you've come in with quite the attitude today. Usually he's all tired, but well done, mate. Great start to the day.
No, I'm knackered, so I'm trying. I'm tired. I want to get this done.
Yeah, it was a tough loss against a better opponent, I guess. They just stuck to their system, and we obviously didn't play well, but you can't give a team like Penrith a 14-0 head start, and we didn't hold the ball in the first half, and it's a tough pill to swallow, but it's a good season to take some lessons out. Oh, good start time in the season to take some lessons out of.
What are those lessons?
First of all, hold the ball. Second of all, work harder on fifth tackles. I feel like we got found out a lot. And I myself as well, like everyone in the team, but the way they sort it, because we've got the best team in the air in the comp, with our edges, but the way they sort of manoeuvred the ball around, ran down short sides, kicked back inside, we kind of kept us sleeping, and we paid for it at the start. So,
what did you make of the obstruction? The Joey Manu no try.
Yeah, see, I thought that was a bit tough. Just because I get that it's black and white, but it's so far away.
Mm. What do you make of the NRL Graham Annesley coming out and saying it should have been given a try?
You see, I don't mind when they do that. Like, they own up to their mistakes. They come out and say it. Like, it's frustrating for fans and for players, obviously, but it's better than them just ignoring the whole situation. Oh, that's what I think. It's annoying, but my opinion is it's a better outcome than them just sitting back and going, well.
Yeah. It's a strange one, this. It's so difficult, and it's split me. I don't know, because it's a bit like the pendulum will swing. So if we go black and white, people go, oh, well, you've got to exercise common sense. And then you go all common sense. It's like, well, that one's 50-50, couldn't have gone either way. We need black or white, so.
I saw Graham Annesley say that the bunker has the right to use discretion.
Yeah, and they probably should have exercised it at that moment.
If that was their discretion.
That was their discretion, but it's a tough ask for those people in the bunker to, with the pressure on, and obviously after last week's one with Trbojevic and Luka Moretti. Like that was.
Yeah, see, I find a little bit different is when Edwards ran into Hargreaves, he didn't like put up his hands and look at the ref and go like, oh.
Yeah.
Like he just knew that he had run into him. Like he didn't.
He made the referee aware straight away though.
Yeah, did he?
And obviously and the bunker then they review every try.
Mm.
But then Tupanua got. Was it Liam Martin ran a line?
Yeah, I think in the game they said he did his best to get out of the way.
That's what the referee said.
Yeah, and he did his best to get out of the way and he didn't affect the play. But the thing is, if you are the four-man defender, you're trying to release your half.
So you are.
Like maybe the bunker doesn't see it, but because Luke Keary has to come in on that player instead of waiting for Tupanua to come through, you're then affecting.
Nah. I know exactly what you mean.
Yeah.
You people don't understand, like, just a slight chink in the armor or a slight move or a player not being there affects your decision, like the domino effect later down the line.
Yeah, it's all who say, she say, though. Like, if we get that try, do we win? But at the end of the day, we lost the game. Like, we lost it because we didn't start as hard as they started. Like, that's the just black and white for the game. They outplayed us.
Do you reckon you're underprepared with Nathan Cleary being out?
Nah, definitely not.
Not at all?
Nah. We didn't leave any stone unturned. Like, we prepared that we were playing the best Penrith side. We just, errors at the start killed us. And, Yeah, they're just the champion team, and they don't falter from their game plan. They just stick at their systems, and that's something everyone can learn from. And they're just super good at what they do. Like, they study the rules and all that. Like, pretty much the refs bringing in a new rule that Mitch Kenny can't do that thing, but like, no one else was doing it. And now, because Penrith's doing it, it's something that's the wrong thing to do.
Are you talking about the
pass and then follow?
Pass and follow.
I tried to do it, and then Mitch Kenny just smoked me on my bum. I threw it past, and he must have known I was trying to do it. And then, yeah,
it's to be honest, as an observer of the game, I was surprised. Mm. I was surprised that Penrith beat you. Like, I really was. I thought. And it's made me wonder, like, I really like the Roosters, but I'm starting to think, like, now, like, well, are you going to have to change how you play?
Or are you just saying this stuff because we're playing the Bulldogs?
No, actually, I'm not. No, I'm genuinely not. You're in trouble this week, mate. I just wonder if Roosters might change their approach. Because I remember in 2018, one of the years the Roosters won the comp, the Dragons beat them on Anzac Day, and Trent Robinson saying that was the catalyst. Mm. That loss was the catalyst for a rethink in how they would attack. And I just wonder if it's going to change, that game is going to change how maybe Roosters defend. Mm. I don't know. I guess you
definitely.
Probably, yeah.
I mean, I can't say, but we've had a lot of meetings, and obviously the lessons I just talked about. Mm. But like I said, it's early on in the season, and it's better to lose games like that this early. But again, a positive is we were still in the fight till the 80th minute.
Yes.
Same with the Manly game. We were in the fight right until the end, and being 14-0 down at the half, it's a good sign. So
yeah, no, most definitely. You certainly didn't give up, and hard to beat a team that doesn't know how to give up, or that doesn't give up. So, apart from that, what do you get up to over Easter?
Lots of chocolate Easter eggs.
Lots of chocolate Easter eggs.
I'm so glad it's over. But my mum came, my niece, my brother, they all came down, from Brisbane. And yeah, mum just loves sweets, and she's just put a lot of Easter eggs in the cupboard, and they're still there. And you know, I'm obliged to.
It's hard when they're there. It's like they're talking to you.
And I stole a heap from the club as well. I think they got like 40,000 of these lint eggs. They're like red, and they got gooey inside, and they're those little golden bunnies.
Did you bring any?
I've got about 300 in the.
At your house?
Yeah.
Did you not bring any for the buy around?
No. I've seen your waistline lately.
Fucking hell.
I did just make a lamb roast at home, though.
I was just going to ask you, with the family being down, did you take them out or did you cook?
We went out for a brekkie, and then we went to the fish market, Sydney Fish Market, and then we whipped up a big seafood, oysters, prawns, lobster.
Why'd you go all the way to the sea?
Have you been there?
I have been there.
Fresh fish in Sydney?
It's a bit repetitive though, isn't it?
What do you mean?
Well, it's like all the same. Just like
fish. It's not the same because it's come straight to the port.
Yeah, I know that. I'm aware of that.
Instead of being shipped.
Why didn't you go to your fish shop around the corner?
There is a reason. My little brother played at Wentworth Park.
Is that convenient? So the local fish shop was the Sydney Fish Market?
No, it was just right down the road. And I was like, Mum, you love your seafood? Do you want to go to the fish market?
It's a bit overwhelming.
It's quite a thing to experience, the fish market. We saw an 11-kilo crab there. Do you know how big 11-kilo crab is? About the size of this right here.
Yeah.
And the pincers on it are like that long, mate. And it had a goatee.
Really?
I don't know if you've seen Moana.
Yes, I have.
You know that crab? She wanna be shiny.
Yes, yes.
Yeah, Tamatoa. He was in the bloody fish tank, Tamatoa.
Okay, well, that's probably worth the visit. But I mean, I don't know. I've been there.
It was about $3,000 to buy that crab. And I was thinking, if I was to buy that crab and put it in a little aquarium at the front of my house, mate.
You charge people, you make money on that.
Oh, but that's the thing. I thought the fish market we saw, my older brother was saying, mate, like, you've come here and you're just staring at all the lobsters and that. It's not an aquarium. It's a fucking fish market. Like, pull your heads in us. But could you imagine letting that crab out? Like, go. Like,
just roam
the house. No, roam the house.
Roam the house.
Or if you'd roam the street, imagine walking down the road and seeing an 11-kilo crab coming out. That thing would eat a dog. It's that big.
Throw it into, like, a daycare center. Watch all the kids lose their shit.
And I also wanted to know if it was fast. Like, you know, crabs are pretty nippy.
It's a lot of lateral movement with crabs. Like, they're not very good at going. They go forwards terrible. Like they love a shift side to side.
Why did the crab get 10 in the bin? Too much of this.
Oh, God. For those of you that are listening to this podcast, Jesus Christ. Impersonated a crab, which is back chat. So that is brilliant. That's a great joke for a tired person. No visit to the Johns household.
No, it's been a while. Cooper's been a bit too busy for me. Yeah, why do you ask?
Oh, we had Matty on.
I did see that.
You were brought up. Says you overdo it with his wife.
She's a beautiful lady, inside and out. Oh,
he said he caught you complimenting her when you didn't realise.
He didn't. Yeah, well, he caught me, but he's put a hidden camera in a bloody Uber. How do you do that?
Oh, really?
Have you not seen that?
Oh, no, I didn't realise that was what he was talking about.
They put me in this Uber. Well, they told me they were giving me an Uber. They put me in this Uber, and then they've ended up putting all these hidden cameras, and I couldn't see them. Like, there was one, like...
That's the idea, between hidden cameras, isn't
yeah,
it?
Yeah.
You know what? They put this hidden camera in there. Couldn't see it. Imagine that.
They had Hindy and that were following us, and they were talking and telling the driver what to say. But at the start, the driver told me he had, like, autism. So I was like, I took everything he said, I was taking it like, oh, like he's special, like I'll just answer all the questions like nicely. And turns out he wasn't. So that guy's going to hell.
Yeah.
Kept saying, it was ridiculous. I had to ring up Cooper and be like, bro, your dad's got me a driver. He's really wigging me out. Like, he stopped at this gas station and was like throwing toilet paper around in the gas. Like, he really played his role. And then he come back and he just brought me all these snacks, and I was like, what the hell is going on? Like, that doesn't sound bad, but it was just weird. I didn't ask for any.
So how did Matthew Johns come up? Well, and then
he's asked me, like, about Trish Johns. He said, oh, you go to Maddie's house, like, how's Trish Johns? Like, she's gorgeous, gorgeous lady.
That could have gone really bad, couldn't it?
No,
but I'm saying, like, if you did go.
Yes, if I was a dirtbag, it could have gone more. But yeah, when I got there, I just felt like killing the bloody Uber driver. Eh?
Yeah, there are some bad Uber drivers out there. Like, I've been in some shockers where I've texted my loved ones and saying, look, I just want you to let you know, I care about you guys a lot. Love you all. If I don't make it, like, I've had some shockers. Some shockers.
Like, for example?
Just driving erratically.
I don't mind that. So you get me there fast.
Yeah, I'm all about getting there. Get me there in one piece.
I don't like the stinky ones, bro.
No.
Get in there and you can just smell ass sweat. Like, it's just straight poo.
Yeah, that's not a good experience. It's do you comment on, do you leave a review and say, smell not great?
Nah,
you can't. It's something you can't really do because they know who you are.
Nah, even if
they probably know a lot of the time, they know where you live.
Exactly.
So
I wonder if they know, like, straight away, this guy's left a comment. Like, as soon as you get out, Jimmy Graham's left a comment. I'll drive back to Jimmy's house and shit in his litter box.
Yeah. Well, that's it. They know where you live. They know when you're going away as well. A lot of the time, if you get an Uber to the airport.
Back to the Matty Johns thing. I think that Trish lives in a house full of boys. She lived with Cooper, Jack, and Matty. And obviously she's outnumbered 3-1. And they don't like to play games with her. Like, she's a games fanatic, super competitive. When I go over there, I love to play games.
What type of games?
Like Bananagrams, Scrabble. Cards, any card game. Pretty much any game. And she really competitive. And then she loves when I come over because I'm the only one that plays or gives her attention, really. So then she says I'm a favourite.
Hey, if you play your cards right.
Mate, hey. All I'm saying is if Maddie, if it, some fingers crossed nothing happened, but if it, something goes wrong, I will look after Jack and Cooper and the family. All of them.
Nah, he was an absolutely fantastic chap, by the way. He was
who,
awesome.
Jack or?
Matty.
Matty is fantastic, yeah.
Right.
I told you the passport story, how he... I left my passport in New Zealand. And then somehow... This was 11 p.m. We've all been on the piss the whole night. And I've had a flight the next day to go to New Zealand. I realised it was COVID year that my passport was in Melbourne when I was living in... And I figured out the day... Like the night that the day before I was leaving, about 11 p.m. I was going, mate, my passport is in Melbourne. And then we tried to figure out a way to drive to Albury, and then my uncle would pass the passport over the border because he could cross the border with a truck license and all that. It's like an 11-hour drive. And then Maddie goes, mate, let me just make a call. And he was pissed theirs at the time, like very drunk. And he made all these phone calls and he goes, gives me this number and says, when you're at the airport, just ring this number and give it to the receptionist, the person at the counter. And I rang up the thing, passed it over, and they're like, all right, Mr. Smith, come through. And I got to New Zealand without a passport.
Did you?
Yeah, I just had to go and print out a copy of it, so a photo of it, print it out, and I just used it everywhere I went. It's not what you know, it's who you know, Gemma.
You know, mate, you know what?
He's on the phone to like the boss of Sky. He's pretty well pissed. We've been drinking since 4 p.m. It's like 11, and he's just making all these phone calls. Mate, he's unreal fella, Matty.
It would have been a great get if he just goes, just cheese, I've sorted it. Turn up to the airport, give this number. You bounce up like, hey.
I'll ring up. It's
4291. Yeah, just call them. Say it's Brandon Smith, Matty Johns is... made the call for me. And it's just like, have you got your passport, mate? You're like, no, call the number. Just do it.
It's just Gaz Johns and Elliot. What the fuck do you want?
That would have been brilliant. But thankfully he come trumps for you. Speaking of coming up trumps, yes.
Yeah, off the Matty Johns show now, let's go to the bye round.
Yes, let's go to the bye round. The Lockie Galvin... the Simbin, I think that was fair. He'll probably be looking at some time on the sidelines. Yeah. He's been 2 weeks, or looking like 2 weeks at the time of recording. Tell you what.
It's pretty identical to the other one.
Mm.
Matt?
Plath.
Plath, Matt Plath.
Benji Marshall there. He's shown a lot of faith in such a youngster to start him in the halves, to start the season. Tigers also winning, only using 15 players. I think Kapoa and Sullivan didn't get on. So such a gutsy win. The way they held their nerve defensively. Look, there are some issues with the Parramatta Eels in their attack without Mitchell Moses that they desperately need to address. I think it's clear now why they were making the beeline for Mitchell Pearce. But the credit to the West Tigers defensively, the attack through Galvin, it was sensational.
Mm. I think what the most impressive stat for me when I was watching the game was 52 tackles or 53 tackles in the opponent 20 in the first half.
Mm.
Like, that is astronomical numbers in the first half. It just, there's no arm wrestle in that. It's just you're getting pounded on. And then even when they finished that set, they rolled 100 metres and then they kicked a 7 tackle.
Yeah, I know.
They rolled 100 metres.
They conceded a couple of six again. They did like 18 tackles on try line, which a lot of teams do in training.
Mm.
Turn them away, and then that next set is just about surviving.
You've got momentum somehow.
Yeah.
And you know what I loved? Seeing Justin Olin play back to his footy. obviously had a tough time at Melbourne to finish and then getting back. For some reason, him and Bateman look like they're the two best friends. Every time they do something good on their edge, it's the biggest, most emotional hug you've ever seen. So they're building that. And they couldn't be two more polar opposite people either. One's a soft-spoken like little PNG lad and one's a tall, white Pommy that can't shut up. They're complete opposites.
It was a fantastic win for the Tigers Easter Monday. It all went down to the wire as well. But before that, the Eels had a couple of opportunities to take the two and go to 6-6. And just wonder whether that would have built them into the game because their goal line attack, like their attack on try line.
No, I agree because I think that what they did was build the Tigers' confidence. Like they just kept turning them away. I reckon when the Tigers, when they finally kicked that penalty at the end of the half, the Tigers were thinking, that's a win for us. That's massive. A massive win for us. Still, they're in the fight, but that Lachie Galvin, is it Lachie?
Yeah.
He's pretty special player. Like 18, I think of Nathan Cleary when he was 18. Like he wasn't doing... Like, he was good, but he wasn't doing things like, winning the Tigers games like that.
Yeah, he set two up. The try he set up for Olam in the first half, that was a great situational awareness kick. That was fantastic.
And then the other one was an unbelievable pass on the inside. Oh, man,
that was sublime. It was like he timed it to perfection.
You know when the commentators go, oh!
Yeah, it was perfect. He had a wow of a game. He really did. We thought it was over, and then the penalty. Could you imagine if Gutherson had knocked that kick over? Like,
you'd feel for Benge and John Morris and everyone in that coaching board. But that's just how it goes sometimes. And so you get what you deserve in this life, and they probably deserve that win.
I think the Tigers did. They did. And it was built off defense. Like,
which is very unusual.
Well, speaking of close wins, South Sydney got over the line. Good Friday against the Bulldogs. Watching that game, it's the best South has played. Their completion rate was higher than
high 90s
all season. I think they only made one.
I think it was 95%.
Yeah, so one incompleted set. But yet the Bulldogs still dominated possession. South Sydney. There were some discipline issues, some penalties. I felt the Dogs could have got a couple more, but it wasn't to be. But the Bulldogs' goal line attack, just missing out on that last class pass. And sometimes that's what you need.
I watched this game with all the boys, actually, and I thought for sure the Bulldogs were going to take it home. But it was Addo Carr going was a kind of a big loss because you don't really have replacements for wingers and then you got to shuffle the whole team around and... That could have probably played a part in the goal line attack because that happened pretty early on.
It happened just on half time.
Yeah, first half.
But then the second half, I don't think the Bulldogs scored a try or a point. So it did throw them out a little bit. And just even, like Stephen Crichton when he's 2-on-2 with Whiten and I think it was Karaz at that point on the right wing. Karaz on AJ. If Crichton tackles Whiten when he passes the ball, Whiten's not in there, and he probably should have done. Now he's probably backing Karaz to make the tackle.
Yeah,
but if he just takes him out, like you're entitled to tackle him to the ground, and then he doesn't score. But the Bulldogs, I've got to give them so much credit. They're so close to nailing it. It's got to stay at it. And if Souths play like they had done in previous weeks, I think they win.
Yeah,
and win convincingly. But if they keep turning up with that same level of intensity, same level of energy, same level of effort, they're going to start to win some games. It's just unfortunate you come up against Souths that complete at, 95%, 97%?
Yeah. So it's going to be tough to beat any team that holds the ball that well. And, mate, that Jacob Preston.
Oh, with a broken jaw.
Come on with a broken... I've broken my jaw, and there is not a single way I could have gone back out there and played. You can't, like, every contact, it feels like the thing's swinging off.
Yeah, I was surprised to see him come back on because I thought he was down for long enough.
Yeah.
I'm surprised it was not given a cat one and was given a cat two, but that just shows the toughness of the man to continue on. So I think he's going to be out for a couple of weeks. South Sydney, the pressure valve just dials down a little bit on Jason Demetriou. Mm. But
lucky they signed Wyden, because if they didn't have him, yeah. It was a grim day.
Yeah, the pressure comes down or just gets released a little bit. They've got the Warriors this week, which should be a great game.
It's going to be a tough one.
Looking strong with that comfortable victory over Newcastle. I thought, you know, the Warriors, they sort of toyed with them a little bit, could have put them to bed, but didn't. So they'll come over to South Sydney. They're in good form. They're 2-2. Unfortunate for Metcalf with that broken leg. Yet to be determined how long he'll be out for, but the likes of Wade Egan, Fanua Blake, Roger Tuivasa-Sheck was immense.
I think Chunk Snigle-Clock's back next week.
I think he is back this week. If you were playing at the Warriors, what would you do with that, the makeup of that team?
It's hard to say, because Roger Tuivasa-Sheck is an unbelievable fullback. But it depends, like, on the team. Like, he can play center better than I think Chance can, and you've got to have both of them in the team, and I think no question, if you ask Roger to play center, so Chance, he wouldn't even think about it. He's one of those guys that is just so team orientated that it's not even a big ask. Like, he wouldn't ever go up to the coach and be like, mate, I should be playing fullback. Like, you know, Zach Lomax doesn't want to be a winger. Like, that's not an option for Roger.
Mm.
It's, what do you, go up to the coach, what do you want me to do? Center, boom, sweet.
I think that's probably where he'll play as well. Charles Nickel-Cluxton was all class last year.
Yeah.
But
you got to at least give him a crack anyways. Yeah. And if it doesn't work out, I'm sure they can change it.
Yeah.
But I think I think the Bunnies are in trouble there, because the way the Warriors play is exactly how the Bunnies do not like to play. So Bunnies are a team that like stop start footy. They don't like live ball, like the ball in the field. Whereas Warriors are the complete opposite. They love the ball and play, and they're the best field position team in the comp at the moment. If you go by the stats, so they've tackled the most people inside their 10 meter line, and they've caught the ball the most inside their 20 to 30 line. So you know what I mean? They're returning from their 20 to 30, and they've got the most amount of tackles inside their 0 to 10.
Yeah, so they're dominating the territory.
Last week it was Warriors, Penrith, us, and now it's Warriors, Penrith, I don't know. Because it's definitely not us.
Interesting. Yeah, the Warriors look like, I don't even think they're playing anywhere near the potential yet either. Mm-hmm. I think they've got a few levels to go. The Brisbane Broncos back to winning ways, every team now has lost. The Cowboys were the only undefeated, so there's no undefeated teams in the competition. Adam Reynolds showed what he's all about. He was amazing on Friday night with the boot. And then some issues around the Cowboys middle, 2 tries from dummy half that were pretty simple. So Cowboys will be filthy, but credit to the Broncos in that derby clash up there.
Yeah, I didn't get to catch all of this game, but I did see Smoothie go over. But I'm pretty disappointed, because I thought the Cowboys were going to get him with all those outs. I tipped them, obviously, and I guess they're just a class team no matter who they've got. They've still got enough strike in their team to be able to perform. So shout out to Tommy Dearden. That's probably the best try-saving tackle I've ever seen.
That was insane.
Like, that was a 100-meter chase pretty much.
Yeah. From the opposite side of the field.
From the opposite side of the field, and just like the technique required to like pull that off.
And the awareness to not make the tackle and then Cobbo score.
Yeah.
Like, he still has some work to do.
Mm.
Like, even once he's made the tackle, he still has to get him over the sideline.
Yeah, like, and he's holding him so his legs are like touching the side. Mm. Yeah. It was unbelievable. I thought that was going to spark something. Yeah. I thought it was going to spark something. And it's still interesting to see how they're using Jason Tomalolo, because he's still not getting those big minutes.
Yeah.
And,
but there were some issues around the middle defensively, like Tyson Smoothie, basically walked over from dummy half, Walters out, show and go.
Yeah.
He actually went past Tamalolo. Tamalolo turns out for the lead runner.
Mm.
So there's some issues there defensively, how they connect. But the Cowboys are still start the season 3-1. But Brisbane needed that win, especially they were down on troops. But Adam Reynolds, take a bow. He put an absolute masterclass with the boot.
It's amazing what you can do with a halfback that can kick like that.
Yeah. You can see it when teams don't have that person with the ability to get a big boot on the ball.
And I wonder how the Souths are feeling about that.
You do have to wonder. You really do. But, I mean, that's football. You're going to lose some players, and it's a long time ago now. They certainly will have moved on. Cheese, your Dragons. They're a Rafa Talamara catch away from being 3-1, but it wasn't meant to be. They put on a great performance against Manly, who were shocking. But credit, the combination between Hunt and Sloan, that kick back, that was class. That was all class.
Mate, Tyrell Sloan is having a hell of a start to the season. I don't know what happened with Manly. Like, I can't really say anything bad about them because they absolutely destroyed us. But I think they just had a bad night out. But that's all you can really put it down to. And the Dragon, mate, my Dragons, I'm telling you. They're not the worst side ever. They played terrible one week, not so long ago. But, upset of the week, boys. I said it on the recent potty that we're on.
Mm.
Mate, if you got on my bets, you'd be up at least $500. if you had bet on every single team I put money on, you're on up about $100. I had some roughies in there.
Yeah, you did. I've been awful this year. Absolutely.
I think
awful.
I went 6-8. No, 5-8.
5-8. That's pretty good. That's pretty good. It was good. It was interesting to see on that kickback. I think that was Shane Flanagan having some insight. Obviously, he was there as assistant last year, and I reckon he's gone. If Tommy's on the short side filling in, kickback because no one fills in. And spoke to Aaron Woods about that, and he was filthy at the Manly middles for not moving.
Mm.
But it's easy to say there in video, you got to move, but then you just get stuck.
Yeah.
And the ability to look up, see the awareness, go, oh, well, Tyrell Sloan's there, so I'm going to start to run back. Before you know it, the moment.
How many tries did he
get? Gone. I think he got two. Zach Lomax had a shock with the boot as well. He missed. He had one howler. But, I mean, I'm the goal kicker. speaking of teams near the bottom, the Titans, again, they blew a significant lead.
14-0
against the Dolphins. Then they clicked into gear. The Dolphins lost a player, Max Plath, for that hip drop tackle, go down to 12, but then they looked the dominant team for the Titans. Dez gave them a spray at full time. For me, that's a half-baked spray. I've seen him. That's him at 50%. He's still got plenty of gears to go. I just don't know. Like, I honestly can't put my finger on it, but speak to a few people around the traps and it's like, what's going on there? Because to start the season, like, you would think, they'll fancy that. The Dragons, the Dogs, the Dolphins, and a bye. You, like, many people with the new coach, like, I know the impact Dez can have. It's insane that it's hard to see them.
Yeah.
Like, and it's hard for them because there's so many tough games to come.
Yeah, it's hard because you just like you feel for them and you don't really want to say anything bad. But I don't know. I don't have the answers for
it. I don't know who in that group, because when you're on the end of a spray like that, I know what it's designed to do. Like, I know what Dez is trying to do, and he's going to shatter you to pieces, but you need some people to pick you up.
Mm.
And that's what we did in the past. It's like, I know what he's doing here. Right, let's get around. Let's respond.
Yeah.
Let's respond to our gaffer. But I don't know, with Notino in there, you know, Kieran Foran, you know, he's the most experienced, but in the halves, and whether or not he's out there on the training paddock as much as he would like, I just don't know where it comes from. And like I say, the level of opposition is only going to increase. Could be a long year for the Titans, man. I feel for them. And again, blowing another lead. Like, they had a habit of that last year. In fact, it was the Dolphins that ran them down in last year. I think they were up by 18 26. Or 20. 26?
Yeah.
Yeah, the biggest ever comeback.
26, lost 28-26.
Yeah, to be fair to the Dolphins, they're a fast team.
They also had a 24-1 against Manly.
Yes.
1 year I watched.
Yeah.
And Manly come back and won like 50 to something.
What have you made of the Dolphins start to the year? Because I think they're currently sitting top of the league.
Yeah, well, they're 3-1, aren't they? I think they had a bye.
Yeah, 2-1 with the bye. Yeah. So.
Well, who have they played? They played the
Cowboys.
Lost to them convincingly.
And they beat the Dragons and the bye and the Gold Coast.
Yeah.
So they
played very well against the Dragons, and I think Hemisai's flying at the moment. He's got a lot of confidence, but it's hard to get a gauge off, I guess, those two games and
when they come
against a side. I'm not saying the Dragons were a bad side. The Gold Coast are currently a bad side. But it's a test, like someone like Para, where they're not there, but they're thereabouts. Someone like that, if they get a convincing win on them, then you've got to take them sort of seriously with the, I guess, premiership sort of contention. Yeah. But it's hard to get a gauge at the moment. And it's so early in the season. Like, there's a lot of games this season. There's still, another 23 to go.
Strap yourself in, geez. Or stay strapped in. The little baton from the hammer was pretty classy. I'm not a massive fan of that, because I think more often than not it doesn't come off, but when it does, you can understand why players of his ability try to do it, right?
Yeah, he's got magic, and you don't mind when the people with magic in their bones can do those things. So
No, I agree. Speaking of chase down losses/victories, the Raiders off to an absolute flyer, 18-0 up, and the Sharks ran them down. You can understand why Ricky Stewart was so pissed off in his post-match press conference.
Yeah.
That's a pissed off, I know we should have won that game. And if you look at how Canberra have played, like 18-0 up, Sharks down on troops in the middle, just bore the audience to sleep and go and win 20, kick a penalty, go and win like 20 points to 6. Thanks for coming. But yeah, sticky. Ricky Stewart was filthy.
Yeah, I didn't see Ricky after the game. I'm glad he comes from the same kettle of fish as Craig Bellamy. So I can only assume what it looked like. But yeah, obviously when you're up 18-0, it's a tough one for the coach that take that all in, but that's the sort of thing that good teams need to do. Like, if you give Penrith 18-0, they're winning. You know what I mean? Yeah. The good teams go out, they put scores on, they win.
Establish that lead, it's lights out.
And other teams know that. Like, mentally you're thinking, we've given Penrith an 18-0 lead, it's over. Like, not that you're thinking that at the time, but you've got a little thing in the back of your head going, fuck, it's going to be tough to bring this back.
Yeah, so you're going to feel like that when the Dogs are up 18-0 against you this week.
Yeah, got to. Nah. See, that's the thing. The Dogs are not worried about the 18. We might throw them a bone. 18-0. But what was I going to say? Yeah, the Sharks. What do you make of this season? I think the best team I reckon I've watched in the comp is the Warriors. But they should be they should be 4-0. They blew 8 points in 3 minutes against the Storm, and they should have won that round one game.
Well, I think that's what I really liked about the Sharks, is that they held their nerve over there in New Zealand. They were under the cosh massively first half.
It was lights out, I thought.
And Nico was amazing defensively, but then they switched off against the Tigers.
I think Sharks are going well. If I'm to measure teams, I would give them the tick of approval.
Yeah. I still think Penrith are the team to beat.
Yeah. Oh, they're definitely the team to beat.
Yeah.
They're sort of like a given.
Yeah. Oh.
Because they've currently got three championships in the last 3 years. Yeah. I would just say they're kind the team
a,
to beat.
Kind of a given, you isn't it? Mean? Yeah. It is. Four rounds in, though, Cheese. You face the Bulldogs next week. I hope they go easy on you so you can do jam and cheese and you're not covered in blood.
Yeah, when I'm in the Hurt Locker, should I just go, boys, Gemma, me and
yeah,
Gemma.
Yeah. I've got jam and cheese next week.
Hey, mate, Gemma.
Go easy. Yeah. Questions from listeners. Now it's time for this. Let's have a look. NK Walker_blindfold. Run straight and as hard as you can. Oh, right. Okay. Yeah. Sorry. Thanks, Charlie. I have misread that. I thought that was his username, but no. NK Walker with the blindfold on, run straight and as hard as you can. Who would you least likely to get hit by?
No, least want to get hit by.
Yeah. That's what I said, right? Who would you least want to get hit by? I'm going to answer that. I'm going to go someone that you
can like in a tackle? Season.
Well, I'm assuming. I'm going to go Kafusi.
Yeah, ooh. Nah, see, Kafusi's a specialist rib shotter. Hey, if you're running straight at him, it's not going to hurt as much as... I don't reckon. I would hate to get hit by Hamoli. I've seen him body blokes. And he's a big boy.
Yeah, I think I'm still...
Or wrong. Mike Tyson. I wouldn't want to be punched in the face by Mike Tyson when I'm running straight at him.
That's fair enough.
Because it didn't really specify.
That's true. Weiss, if 89, should Crichton go to fullback and Sexton in to replace Hutchison? What do you reckon?
No.
I can see the appeal as a fan. I really can. But I've got to trust the coaching staff that they know what they're doing. Because... I thought Crichton was coming as a fullback. And I really like what Toby Sexton bought last year, but I'm not there every day. So I've got so the answer is the fanboy in me says yes, but the old footballer knows that they know best.
Yeah. I just think he's one of the, if not the best centers in the game.
Yeah.
Why would you change positions?
That's
my thoughts.
That's true. Ricky_Gervais. Yeah, Ricky Gervais is in. Ricky_Pohatu.
Pohatu.
Yeah, okay. Ricky_
Rocky Pohatu.
Oh, yeah, Rocky, not Ricky.
Can someone please get this man some glasses?
That is really bad for me, isn't it? Rocky Pohatu. Should referees do press conferences? Absolutely fucking not.
What is that? Could you imagine that?
Could you imagine after the game? They'd just be awful. They've got no charisma anyway. They've got no personality. They should be.
Well, I actually don't mind them when you go in Las Vegas.
I'm joking. At the All Stars as well.
I ran into a few of those. Geez, you guys are actually pretty fun.
They are. I've seen a few of them at the beach and they're all good fellas. They really are. But doing press conferences, no, they shouldn't. They shouldn't be needing to explain their decisions.
Which opponent's gamemanship pissed you off the most? I mean, you were a bastard.
Me?
On the field.
Gamesmanship?
Yeah.
What? Describe gamesmanship.
Like, isn't that not like cheekiness on the field?
No, gamesmanship is like...
I think that's what they mean. Who pisses you off the most in the field?
Chambers was always a bit of...
he was, but he stayed that bloke, whether you're on the field or you're off the field. At training, anything, it's all out war with him.
I can imagine him being like that.
Some of the fans spray him, he's coming straight back.
He used to get under someone.
He's definitely the best, though.
Yeah. He was always running his mouth. I think gamesmanship is like bending the rules. like running blockers.
Oh, really?
Yeah, but I don't know. It's hard for me to think. But no,
I'm Reed Martin pisses me off. I'm playing him this week.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
You'd hate him too. Don't play.
Oh, really?
Yeah, don't pretend.
I don't know if I ever played against Reed.
No, you didn't.
No. Missed him.
Your last year was 2018.
No, my last year was 2020.
2020?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Then you would have
faded into insignificance, Jesus, unfortunately.
No,
what are you doing? You've been retired. No, I'm still playing, mate. Fucking cheers. Nice one.
Were you at the Dragon still?
Yeah. 2019. Shocker. 2020. Got out. to go back home. So I only played just after COVID finished. Well, after the season got shut down. Well, geez, we both brought a lot of energy to this podcast.
I think your yawning made me yawn. So
yeah, it's been a long ass day. Been a long Easter too.
It is 8 p.m. for our listeners at the moment.
We're here. We came. We delivered. We care about you, Byron listeners. So thank you for listening. We'll catch me and Cheese next week. Charlie White is back for Midweek Matters. So,
and a huge congratulations to Charlie.
Excited
every one
to
of
see,
our listeners. A massive congratulations.
Excited. I know everyone is itching to find out how the early season break went.
It took a mental health. True. It's mentally fatigued 3 weeks into the season.
Yeah, he's over us already. I mean, talk about timing. Now, don't worry, Charlie. We just have our biggest guest ever coming on the bye round. No worries. You go away, mate. We'll hold the fort.
That's like, it's funny. We had at Melbourne, we had, I think it was Herb Elliot come to give us a talk. And before the guest speakers do talks, they say like, big background story, what he done. You know who Herb Elliot is?
I know the name.
I think he ran the first sub-5 or sub-4 mile.
No, that was Roger Bannister.
Well, whoever it was.
Roger Bannister was the first sub-4 minute mile.
I don't know what he did.
So what did Herb Elliot?
Herb Elliot is the same thing, same sort of thing.
Well, let's find out.
It must be. It
what
must
did,
be
Charlie,
Australian.
What did Herb?
Yeah.
So he's
got the world record.
The Australian world record holder for the 1500 meters.
Yeah.
Okay.
But a lot. And anyways, we'll keep going. They did like.
No, just end the story there.
They did a talk, and they said, "Oh, this is Herb Elliott. He was classified as the most mentally tough human being on the planet." Blah, blah, blah. And then he said he retired at 22. And the boys asked, like, oh, why'd you retire? He's like, mate, I was mentally fatigued. It's like, well, there's all like 33-year-old, like Smithy's a 36-year-old playing rugby league. And he's not getting touted. He's like, what are we? Mentally fatigued. He's like, you can't be that mentally strong if you're 22 and retiring due to mental fatigue.
I'm done. I've had it with this. Mate, 22, what
mate,
was he thinking?
Like, obviously, full credit to him. He's got his own road outside ANZ. Oh, what is it? A core stadium. He's got his own road. It's Herb Elliott Road out the front there.
I hope it's a mile long or a 1,500-meter road.
Yeah, it turns out he wasn't even running a mile. He's running 1,500.
I know. He's like
he broke down with 100 meters left, but he's still got the world record at 50.
He was just so mentally done. I'm just done here, lad. Give him the game up at 22.
He was going for the 1600 meter world record, but he broke down at 15, so they just stopped it there. He used to say when he trained, I used to always lose in my practice runs, but it's because the people that I was running against would run with the wind. I'd always run against the wind.
Hey, Belly, if you're listening, which is highly doubtful, you have a right to reply.
I don't mean any bad.
All right, we'll wrap it up there. Cheers. Great to see you again. Happy Easter. I hope everyone enjoyed it, and we'll catch you next week. And don't forget, if you haven't listened to the Matty Johns episode yet, please do. You will not be disappointed. What an interview that was. And hold your horses, everybody. Charlie White is back. Wednesday. We'll be called Wednesday. We'll be back for Thursday for you guys.